KPIT Tech came out with numbers not strictly comparable because they demerged their engineering division and given it off, hived it off as well. So there is keep that at the back of your mind. But the company, just about 3 weeks ago, post this was done, after the three-step deal with Birlasoft, the newly demerged company has come out with its earnings for the first time since listing. In a chat with us at the time of the listing, the management had guided for an 18 to 20% growth in the next couple of years. Is the company on track to achieve this target? Let's ask co-founder, MD and CEO, Mr. Kishor Patil, who joins us right now on the show. Mr. Patil, good having you. Thanks so much for joining in. The reported numbers are thus, the revenues at 501 crores, net profit at 30 crores, and margins at about 12.3%. Now, since I can't compare these with any comparables, can you make an apples-to-apples comparison of how the quarter was?
Absolutely. We are first very happy to, report the first quarter post our demerger. The year end really ended on a very good note for us, as we have mentioned. Overall, our revenues on year on year on comparable basis grew by 25% overall, and in the services business, which engineering services business, 30%. So, which is very satisfying and probably the best in the industry. So, from that perspective, and on the year-on-year basis, this revenue growth on the comparable basis would be again more than 14%. So, I think that's a reasonable performance, and the quarter performance was in line with what we have mentioned last time.
Okay. So, in light of that, can we now talk about how do you think the next year is shaping up? When I look at what brokerages make of your new company or the company as it stands right now, everybody says that software is eating the automobile and KPIT is playing into that. That's one of the comments that came in as well. Can you talk about how is the business looking for the current quarter, and how do you expect the year to shape up to be?
Absolutely. I think I want to go back a little bit and talk about last year so that it creates a ground for this year. I think apart from just the number growth, I think what was very satisfying was we executed on our strategy. And our strategy was really to focus on fewer customers, we call T25, top 25 customers, and really have the growth. And more than 80% of the growth has come from these customers. We really focused on the new technologies which are shaping the automotive market. So whether it is electrification, autonomous, etc. And the growth has come in from all the three regions, which is whether it is US, Europe, and Asia. So that has been very satisfying. I think going into the next year, we believe that we are looking at the same to form the growth. We believe that we will continue to grow from our 25 customers. The areas of growth will be the same, whether it is electrification, autonomous, connectivity, and some standardization. So I think this is what will drive the growth. We believe that the growth will be led by Europe and Asia for the next year. Also, US will grow, but I'm just saying this will be forefront for. That's what we believe. At the same time, the industry is going through a lot of changes, automotive. And as you might have seen, there has been major layoffs by major large automotive company. The volume of sales of car have come down. However, the profitability has gone down. But one of the major reason for this is basically technology disruption and where we play exactly. And so we are reasonably confident, bullish about what we are doing and continuing growth momentum. And that's the reason we have mentioned that in next 3 to 4 years, we will become a $500 million company. That's how the outlook we have given. For the next year, we have said that we will be between 16 to 18% outlook for the growth and expansions of margin from where we are today to 14 to 15%. Now, looking at this automotive state of the industry, that's what we have we have been cautiously looking. It warrants a cautious approach, and that's why we have talked about 16 to 18% for this year. At the same time, we have talked about 3 to 4 years outlook for about $500 million revenue.
So am I understanding this correctly, that if indeed the automotive volatility in the globe becomes a lot more linear and predictable, then your growth numbers could be higher than the 16 to 18% that you are, that you've put out?
Yeah, I mean, at this point of time, we believe we feel confident about 16 to 18%. And as the years pan out, we will see what additional opportunities come our way.
Okay. The margin question was going to be the next one. This 12%, 12.5% seems to be a threshold, because you're already talking about reaching about 15% in the next year itself. What happens in the times to come? Because I reckon smaller companies need to get foot in the door. By smaller, I mean on a relative basis. Get a foot in the door with some of your large clients that may come at the expense of pricing and eventually improve margins in a meaningful way. Would that be a trajectory for you as a company over the course of the next 3-4 years as you reach that $500 million dollar guidance that you spoke about?
No, I think KPIT has invested into automotive business for a long time. We have been one of the pioneers for that 15 years plus investment in this industry. And we, in some way, were expecting some of this trend to become more prominent, and we had invested ahead of time. So we believe this specifically in the new areas, there are very few people companies who can really contribute meaningful to some of these production level programs for the automotive industry, and KPIT is certainly one of them, one of the leading companies of that. So we do not enter into an account or with any lower margins or lower rates. So I think not only that, we believe that we have to create we have to be net talent generator, because we are one of the leading companies in this space. So from that perspective, to attract some of the best talents, we need to invest. So from that perspective, that is not our strategy. Our strategy is to really go with a strong positioning and ensure that we deliver on this complex program. So that is our strategy. And I think the margin expansion will be driven major by growth as well as operational efficiencies.
You know, let me rephrase myself. So on a provider focused on mobility, you would be the largest pure play engineering services provider, and which I don't think anybody has a doubt of. My question was more, Mr. Patil, that would you look to, in a bid to enhance your revenue base, look to sacrifice margins in any way? And if not, what is the average near normal margins that you would clock in over an average for the next 3 or 4 years as you look to reach the targets that you've laid for yourself over the next 3 or 4 years?
Sure. So we have looked at, we have mentioned that our outlook is in next 3 years, we will achieve somewhere between 16 to 18% margin. So that's what we have mentioned. I think, we have been investing into technologies and global centers. In Europe region, we have more than double the headcount last year. So some of those investments we are making, and those will get leveraged. And that's how the margin expansion will also happen.
Okay. What about client wins? Mr. Patil, if you can give some color, you've already spoken about how some of the largest companies would be your clients. What's the average size of deal wins that you've had in the last quarter? Does that ratchet up meaningfully over the course of the next few quarters?
Absolutely. I think our pipeline is pretty strong. We don't talk about exact numbers, but let me tell you that our pipeline is pretty strong. And I think we continue to win significant deals, meaningful deals with these customers. So our focus is really to, on these T25 customers, we become, we have the highest wallet share for these customers. And I would say that majority of them we are already, and now we are riding on the additional technical investments they are making and taking the higher part of that share. So we will continue to do that.
My final question. Nobody seems to be able to put a finger on how worse can it get as far as the trade war goes before it gets better, if it does? In light of that, is there a possibility that your current assumptions for 16 to 18% might be revised downwards if indeed the trade war worsens, if there are auto tariffs, and therefore the growth for the automotive industry by and large comes off meaningfully from where you estimate it to be right now?
I think that's why I talked about certain uncertainties into automotive industry. But what we have seen is, there are uncertainties because there is a certain kind of uncertainties between UK and Europe, between US and Europe, US and China. So there are multiple plays. I think one important part we have done, as in that's what I mentioned, probably as compared to any other company, we have very balanced revenues across the region. And in all the three regions, we have establishing centers, which allow us to tap into the local talent and service them there. So I won't say there won't be any impact because, but as I said, most of these automotive companies are very clearly aware that if they do not invest into new technologies, not only they are losing market share today, but their revenues will go down in future. So most of them are not compromising on this technology investment. They are trying to rationalize them through collaborations and mainly regionally. So I personally think that this may have some impact, but it won't be as pronounced impact.